Good day, students. It's been brought to my attention that this video was recorded with no sound, so I'm going to play the video in YouTube and then talk you through what is happening in the video. So the theme 10 is about writing up and presenting research outcomes. It's very important that when one has completed your research, you do a good job of writing up what actually happened. So at the end of this lecture, you should be able to generate a written research report, define the purpose, readership, and limitations of a written report, and then select different people that you do presentations to. Okay, so if you remember, this is our research process that we've been working with, and you will see that this presentation deals with data analysis and conclusions and recommendations. So we did the empirical data analysis when you went to Cliptown, and today I'm going to tell you how to gather the data. How to analyze the data. So for the example, I'm going to use the data from the focus group that I gathered during the when I went to Cliptown, and the focus group that you have the DVD of. And the idea is that I will download the information from SurveyMonkey. That's what's happening now. And that we will then together analyze the information in Excel, using Excel. And we are only going to do very basic descriptive statistics, because for me, if you can do basic descriptive statistics at the end of this course, that is good enough. Because also remember that this is only a 6-month course, so it's not possible to go into detail into statistical analysis in this course. Right, so here is just when you go to the analyze function in SurveyMonkey, it shows you what the detail is. And you can see here, for example, it shows us that 80% of the respondents live in Cliptown, and one of them actually did not want to answer that question. And there is the detailed comments that they made, and qualitative comments. And then that shows whether they were members of KYP when they were at school. And these are basic histograms, and I'm going to show you now in Excel how to draw a histogram and also a bar chart, and then also how to work with numbers, because there are some numbers in the results here. For example, the years that they have lived in Cliptown, and also the age. Okay, so we go to export all, and then we click on open in Microsoft Excel. And you can see that there are different ways in which you can download your data when you are working in SurveyMonkey. But I have access to Excel, and so have you, hopefully. So we will just export it into Excel. It takes a little while, so you will see I just opened another zip file that I had previously downloaded. And you basically click on the zip file. The zip file opens. Okay, there we go. And you then go to the Excel tab, and your data will then be in sheet 1. If you have a large data set, then sometimes it will also go into, or it will create another sheet 2, but in this case there's only sheet 1. The collector list shows you the different collectors that you created. So for example, for your data collection, there was a collector for each of the groups. So if you click on the collector list, it will show you the number of each collector list, but it's not really applicable for this specific survey, but it will be applicable for the data that you captured. Although I have recorded the video that shows you how to just download your data and filter it on SurveyMonkey. Alright, so then we open the Excel spreadsheet, and I'm wondering why it's now taking a while to open it. Okay, there we go. And then once we've opened the Excel spreadsheet, here is our data. So you will see in the first column, it has a respondent ID. And the respondent ID is just something which SurveyMonkey gives to each respondent that replies to your survey. So it's a unique number, and it just counts on, and you can think there are millions of surveys being filled in over the world every day. So every time somebody completes the survey, it just counts on. So normally I just delete that and I replace it with a numbering system of my own. Then that's the collector or ID. That is the start date when the data was when the person started entering the data, and the end date when they finished entering the data. So you can see I captured all this data on the 17th of April because I entered it by hand as you did with your questionnaires. Then it gives you the IP address of the person that entered it, and then in column F, G, and H and I, SurveyMonkey gives you the possibility or the capability to add or to put email addresses and first names and last names and custom data in for each respondent, and then you can use SurveyMonkey to actually send out the links for you. And if you did that, then it would appear over here, but in this case the data was captured face to face and then entered after the fact. So it's helpful sometimes to have SurveyMonkey send out the emails for you if you do have access to the email database, because then you can check whether whether people have responded, so whether a specific person has responded. Okay, so that is basically what that data is all about. But then for your data that you're going to be downloading from SurveyMonkey, you can just ignore that because obviously it will be blank for you as well. Right, so we can then just delete those rows, and we can then insert a column where we then put a participant number, and we just basically number the participants from 1 to 6. Okay, so then the first question was around the position in KYP, and you can see from the data here that the people that took part in this focus group were senior people that are part of KYP. And so in other words, it was the right experts that took part in the focus group. But the interesting thing is that although they are senior people, look at their ages. They are very, very young people that are making such a large impact on the kids in KYP. Right, and the other thing is you can see that the qualifications, five of them have matric and only one has a diploma. Okay, so let's start by doing some descriptive data on the age. So when we have numerical type of information, I then moved on to talk about the highest qualification. All right, and the fact that you can see that only one of them has a diploma, then the number of years that they've been volunteering in at KYP, and you can see that two of them have been there since KYP was established, because it was established 7 years ago, but the rest of them are newer. And then it's interesting on the question of do you live in Cliptown, that one of the participants chose not to answer that question. So I don't know whether that means that he or she actually does not live in Cliptown but doesn't want to say so, because it's a sensitive matter for the people that live in Cliptown. Right, and then in column G we have the qualitative data around why they are living, why they are volunteering at KYP. And so you can see that, you know, they want to make a change. They want to actually make a change to the kids' lives. And we would use content analysis to analyze that data. Right, and then the last question was whether they were a member of KYP when they were at school. Right, so we're going to now start analyzing the data. So we will start with the age, and normally when we have numerical data such as age, we look at the average, the minimum, and the maximum, because all of that gives us a picture of the distribution of the age. So in Excel you just type equals average, and then you select the numbers that you want to average, and so you can see the average is 26.6 years. For minimum you just type equals min, and you then select the numbers that you want, and the minimum age is 22. And for maximum, you just type equals max, and you select the numbers that you want, and the maximum age here is 32. So when we write, or we will write a write-up on this a little bit later, and then I will show you how to handle the data and how to write it. Okay, so on the highest qualification, there are two options that they gave, matric and a diploma in marketing management. So what we want to do is we want to determine how many of them said matric and how many of them said a diploma in marketing management, because we can then use that to create a bar chart or a pie chart. Okay, so the function that you use in Excel is COUNTIF, and you then give the range of data that you want Excel to look at, comma, and you then give the criterion that you want Excel to look at. So in this case we have typed the criteria in the row next to it, so it will then look and see how many, it will count if there are instances of matric happening. And you can see that there are 5 instances of matric. So maybe, you know, when we've got such a small data set of only 6, it's very easy to do it by hand. But you can imagine that when you get to larger data sets of 50 or more, it becomes cumbersome and you make mistakes when you do it by hand. And that's why we rather use Excel, because then we know that we're going to get the right data, and we're going to analyze the data in the correct manner. And then also Excel has graphing functions, so we can then automatically draw the graphs that we need to draw. Okay, so to get the instances of the diploma in marketing management, we do the same thing. We use count if we give the range. The criterion is diploma in marketing management, and you can see that there is one of them. All right. So the count if statement is a very, very powerful and very, very handy statement to know and to use in Excel, especially when you want to analyze data and draw pie charts and draw histograms. Okay, so I'm just waiting to see where I went next. Okay, so the next thing I did was to then draw a pie chart of the data. So in Excel, you just select the data that you want to draw the pie chart of. You go to Insert, you click on Pie, and you select which type of pie chart you want. You can, of course, put it in a separate spreadsheet, but in this case, I just added it to the existing one, and then I added the data labels so that you could see how many people showed that they had a matric and how many people showed that they had a diploma in marketing management. Okay, and you can see that it shows it in two different colors, so it's easy to distinguish. Excel also gives you the ability to put percentages in, but when we work with such small data sets, we don't add percentages. Okay, so now we're going to do the same thing with the number of years volunteering, and because it is the same kind of data as age, we are basically going to use the same formulas. So average, the average years of volunteering is 5.2. The minimum years is 3. Yeah, and then the maximum years, we just say equals max, and we put the numbers in, and it will then give us 7. All right, and as I've said, 7 is a significant number because the program was started 7 years ago, and because there are two people that have been participating for 2 years, it means that these are two of the founding members of the program. Okay, so because 2 is a significant number, we also now want to determine, 7 is a significant number, we also want to determine how many 7s have we found. So again, we can use the count if function, and we give it the range, and we give it the criteria, and then it shows us that there are 2 7s. So again, on a data set of 6, it's maybe not that difficult, but if we had 200 instances, the count if function would have been very, very helpful. Okay, so now we want to look at whether they live in Cape Town or not. So we have yes and no. And again, we use count if. So you can see that count if is really a handy little function to use. And we do exactly the same for no. So we say equals count if. And we give the range that we want Excel to look in. And we give the criteria that we want it to look at. So there we have 4 and 1. And of course, in this case, we know that one of the respondents did not respond. And we can then just put in 1. We can use a function that counts how many blanks there are if we had more data than just the 6 that we have over here. Right, and then this is qualitative data, and this we would have to analyze using content analysis. So we would have to go and look at how many, or we would have to look at what are the ideas that they have put down and to what extent are these ideas overlapping. And we would then do an analysis of that. Okay, so the last one that we want to then analyze is whether they were a member of KYP when they were at school. And so we just insert a column and we can then put the two responses that they were no and yes. It would help if I could spell. There we go, yes and no. And then what function do we use? Of course, the COUNTIF, because the COUNTIF then will work out for us how many yeses we have and how many noes we have. Okay, so I hope that's helped you now and it's clear now how to analyze the data using Excel for simple descriptive statistics. Alright, so now we want to draw a diagram of the yeses and noes. So we select the yeses and noes and we select the numbers all together, and then we go to insert, and in this case we want to draw a histogram. So for the histogram we just select the column chart, and we can take out the series because there is only one series. And here you can see the picture nicely shows us that there were three yeses and three noes. So it depends on you know, your preference, but also the amount of data you have, because probably if you only have yes, no, a pie chart is sufficient. But when you start having more data and you have a lot of issues that you are addressing, then you want to start using a histogram, because otherwise it becomes a bit unclear on a pie chart. Because if you have too many data items crowding a pie chart, it can get quite busy and quite difficult for the human eye to interpret. Okay, so here you can see I'm just busy saving it in a Excel spreadsheet to my hard drive so that I have it for the future. Okay, and there is basically all the analysis of my data. So now what I'm going to do, I think, is to open a Word document, because in research the diagrams and the tables don't talk for themselves. In research you also always have to talk for the data and for the diagrams. And so I'm going to show you how you can now do it in, or how I did it in a Word document. So here you can see that this is just the background or introduction. So a focus group was conducted with the KYP management team on 27 February. The purpose of the focus group was to determine how we measure the impact of KYP on the Cliptown community. And then there's just some information there on the meeting. And you can see that for the data analysis, six members. Okay, so I changed it to data collection and analysis, and six members of the KYP management team took part, and after the requesting that they sign a consent form, they were asked to supply demographic information. The consent form and the demographic information asked are shown in Appendix A and B of this document. Because remember that whenever you write up your research, you have to include your instruments, because your instruments are important because the reader can then go and look at the instruments and compare the data to the instruments, and they can analyze for themselves whether they agree with your analysis. So when one writes an article, you don't always include it because the space is normally limited for an article, but definitely if you are writing up a thesis or a dissertation, you will add all the appendices of all the documents that you use. So here you can see is the consent form. This was also attached to the proposal that I made available to you, and you can see I told them that the focus group was being filmed, that the study may be published, and that it would only be published in summarized formats, and that their personal views will not be made visible when it's published. So in other words, you won't be able to know who said what. Okay, so here is the qualitative data. So I've just put the actual responses of the qualitative data over here, and you will see that at the top, in the top of the document, I have made a summary of what they have said. Okay, and here is the demographic information as I put it into, or the questionnaire that I used in SurveyMonkey to capture the demographic information. Okay, so the first thing that is important to the study is, remember when we do a focus group or a Delphi study, the concept of an expert is very important. So by giving the responsibilities of the members that took part, we show that we have consulted the correct experts. Then you will see that the data that I analyzed in SurveyMonkey, I now present here by taking the average, the minimum, and the maximum, and then just saying the ages of the participants range from 22 to 32, with the average age being 26.6. Oh, actually, that should be 26.7 now that I look at it again. And this gives the reader a feeling of the age range. So if I had 200 points of data, I would have given the same type of information, and the reader would then have an idea of the spread. Okay, so the pie chart of the qualifications of the participants is next, and that is in figure 1, and that just comes straight out of the Excel spreadsheet that we worked on. And then you see that figures don't speak for themselves. You have to speak for them. So you have to then say 5 of the participants have completed matric and 1 participant has a national diploma in marketing management. Because in academic work, figures never speak for themselves. Right, and we just make it smaller so that the figure and its caption go together. So normally we put the caption of a figure below it and the caption of a table above it. And then you will see I did exactly the same thing in terms of the number of years that they volunteered at KYP, and I have said that the participants have been volunteering at KYP between 3 and 7 years. The average number of years that the participants have volunteered is 5.2, and then 2 of the participants have been involved with KYP since it started 7 years ago, because remember we said that was a significant number. Right, then four of the participants live in Cape Town, one participant lives elsewhere, and one participant declined to answer the question. So it's not always necessary to put a diagram, because sometimes the diagrams end up taking up too much space and they don't end up adding value. Right, and this is now the summary of, in summary, the participants want to change the future of the youth of Cape Town and ensure that they have the opportunity to be educated. Participants also love children and want to make a positive impact on the community. So that is my summary of the detailed information that they gave there. And then the last one was, were you a member of KYP when you were at school? The histogram indicating whether participants were members of KYP when they were at school is shown in figure 2. Alright, and do you spot the mistake here? I did not put a sentence that describes the figure. Oh, alright, I see that I am now putting in that sentence. Okay, so this figure shows that three participants were members of KYP when they were at school, and three were not. Okay, so that is because the figure can't speak for itself. You have to tell us what the figure means. Right, and then we have a short discussion at the end, because we've now analyzed the data, but we haven't inferred anything about the data, because the inferences on the data we only do once we discuss the data. And so you can see table 1 indicates that the participants are part of the management team. The relatively young ages of the management team and the fact that 5 out of 6 members of the management team only have matric shows that young people with limited education can make a difference in their community if they set their minds to it. KYP is also a program with continuity, as 2 of the 6 members of the management team have been involved with the program since its inception. It is a grassroots program, as 4 of the 6 participants live in the community. It makes an impact as three of the participants, that was a spelling mistake, as 3 of the participants were themselves beneficiaries of the program and decided to join the program as volunteers when they completed matric. Yeah, so that's basically the discussion, and it's always important to discuss your results and to then make inferences of how important those results are and what it means, what those results mean. Okay, now I'm just waiting for myself to move on. So when you write up your report, you must also remember to put in a discussion and to put in the descriptive statistics that I've asked you to add. Right, so now back to the presentation. And basically there's one slide left, and that's about oral presentations. So there are 2 essential questions that you have to ask before you plan an oral presentation. So the first one is, how long should you plan to talk? If you are doing a presentation at a conference or such, they will tell you how long you have to talk, and also if you are doing a colloquium on your dissertation or thesis. So normally you know how long you have to talk. And then the next thing is, what is the purpose of the presentation? Is it to raise concern about the problem? Are you wanting to add knowledge to the audience? Or is it to give conclusions and recommendations for decision making? So normally when you are presenting the final results of your research, it's about giving the conclusions and recommendations. And it is not about educating your audience, which is adding knowledge to the audience. And very often at conferences, you get these professors who come to the conference and then they give a lecture on the knowledge area rather than giving the conclusions of their study, which is why everyone is actually in the audience. So then people sit and they sleep through the conference. And for that reason, it's very important that you know for yourself before you do your presentation what the purpose of the presentation is and what it is that the people that are listening to you actually want out of your presentation. Okay, and that is the end of writing up and presenting your research outcomes for this course. And of course, if you are going to be doing a master's, depending on whether you're doing qualitative or quantitative, on qualitative you would have to read up more on content analysis, narrative analysis, and those types of things, whereas on the quantitative side you would have to read up more on the statistics and what kinds of statistics you use and where you use them and how and why you use them. But for the 6 months that we have on this course, I feel that descriptive statistics is essential and is enough, because otherwise I kill you with too much information and you don't process the information that you actually get at the end of the day. Right, so that is the end. Let me now just stop it.